Are you serious? Are we on?
No, literally, you have to say yes or no.
Yes, we're streaming.
Okay, we're streaming. Hey, good morning.
My name is Cliff. I'm one of the pastors here at New England Chapel. Still figuring out the signals. Man, it was hard to get up this morning. Yesterday was so beautiful, and today is so not. But we're glad that you're with us. I got two announcements before we get started. Both of them involve your cell phone, so pull it out, would you? So if you go to nechapel.org, that's N-E for New England, chapel.org, you'll see right on the front page, there's a button that says Register for Get to Know NEC. And this is something that Heather leads the first Sunday of every month. And so this coming Sunday, not this Sunday, but the next Sunday, she'll be leading it right after the church service. So at 11 a.m., as soon as the church service is over, you can just go ahead and log in. And this is a great opportunity for you to talk with one of the pastors, figure out what NEC is all about, where our heart is, and also how things work. You know, how the sausage is made a little bit. And that's a good thing, because you might find out how you can get more involved in things, how you can make friends here, how you can find a place here. And so we hope that you'll do that. And as long as you're on that page, you may notice, especially if you are on a cell phone, there's three little bars in the top right-hand corner. If you hit those bars and go to get involved, there's a spot for join a small group. Click that, and you'll notice that we have a survey. And this survey is intended to find out sort of like how you want to get involved, what you have been involved in the past, how much you liked it or didn't like it, and what you might want in the new future. See, we're going to start meeting together. We get to be a church again, which is never a bad thing. And we want to know sort of what you're looking for, what you're thinking about, what you're worried about, what you're working on. And maybe we can do that together. I hope that you use those two tools as an opportunity to get to come be a part of church again. I'm excited. I think a lot of us are excited. So welcome, good morning, and enjoy the service.
Good morning, I'm Mark O'Keefe, and just before I start playing, the weather, you probably can't hear from home, but remotely, the weather is so loud that we can hear the pitter-patter of raining on the roof here. It's a sort of a miserable looking day. And it reminds me of our topic today. So Mike is going to be talking about toxic people. And, you know, a day like this compared to a day like yesterday was so beautiful. It made you want to go out, interact, run, you know, see a baseball game, just have fun and really take in the day and give yourself to the day. On a day like this, we feel like staying in and sort of, you know, cuddling up on the couch and watching a movie and sort of staying away from that weather and not giving anything of yourself to it. And toxic people seem to be very similar. Someone you like a lot, someone you want to be around, you kind of give yourself to them. Whereas the toxic people are so different. You want to shelter yourself away from them and sort of be on your own and kind of push them out. So the songs that Abby and I have chosen today that we're going to sing for you have a lot to do with toxic people sort of from their perspective, trying to look for hope and trying to climb out of where they are. And I think it's really on topic. Go wrong. what should I do next, Teresa? Well, please help me, but don't wait too long. Am I lost? Am I forgotten? Too far from home. I've known love and I've known madness. Must I find my way alone? What should I do next, Teresa? Where did I go wrong? What should I do next, Teresa? Please help me, but don't.
Identity. Thanks, Abby. Thanks, Mark. That was great. Great way to set us up. Great way to prime the pump for God to work in our hearts and minds this morning. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, I pray that in this morning, some of us may be super tired or wanting to multitask or wanting to clean while we watch. Or God, I pray that you just give us a moment to pause and let you do some work in our hearts and our minds. Nobody likes looking at inward at icky things, but I know that when we do that, you free us and you bring new life to us. And so I pray that this morning, this series would be lots of that. We ask for your help in Christ's name. Amen. So why a series on toxic people after Easter? I mean, Easter, we experienced forgiveness and grace and everything was wonderful, and now we're diving into slime, right? Inside slime. And I just want to be very clear that we're not talking about your coworker. We're not talking about your neighbor. We're not talking about your in-law. We are talking about you. We are talking about you and me. The full title of the series is Toxic People, Are You One? And the idea is very much a spring cleaning. We have God's love. We have God's grace. Easter showed us that. We have God's forgiveness, but we also have God's Spirit to empower us to live freer. And so that's the purpose behind the spring cleaning. We wash the windows, we clean out all the we just make the indoors nice, and then we go outside and we pick up all the leaves and we prepare the garden beds and the gardens for good growth. That's what we're doing this series, is we're taking a look inside, letting God in, and letting him free us up from some of the things that hold us back from growth and inner peace. The first week we did mismanaged anger and resentment. Last week we did fear. And I think those two topics are topics that often we will reluctantly admit to. I do fly off the handle sometimes. I do have a resentment streak against certain people. I do have a lot of fear around this topic or this area of my life. I do have a lot of, and we're able to admit to those topics. And part of it, I think, is because we can't fool anybody. If we have mismanaged anger, the people around us know about it. If we have resentments, the people around us know about it, how we talk about people, how we posture ourselves towards people. If we have fear, people can see that too, what we do and don't do. And so those things are pretty obvious, and we can't try to put on a facade because others could easily see behind that through that facade. But when it comes to greed, this topic today, I guarantee none of us are thinking I'm a greedy person. I'll tell you right now, I don't consider myself a greedy person, but I'm going to show you a little bit later how there are pockets of my life that I am greedy. And I want that kind of vulnerability to trigger vulnerability in you. Because this is one topic that Americans need to hear most. And I'm included very much in that. And the scripture that we're looking at a parable that Jesus told to sort of help us think about life and wealth and our interplay with it. And by the end of it, what I hope it to do is, I'm hoping that parable really indicts us all, but then frees us to think in different ways. That's the goal of the series, that's the goal of the sermon, is to give us a breath of fresh air, a freedom from things that hold us back. So let's take a look at that parable. It comes in, let's see, Matthew, Mark, Luke. It comes in the third book in the New Testament. Luke writes a biography of Jesus' life and ministry. He was one of Jesus's, I won't go into the history of it all. I'll take 5 minutes describing who Luke was. Let's look at what Jesus' parable has to say. So speaking to the people, Jesus went on, take care. So like warning, be careful. Protect yourself against the least bit of greed. So we're not just talking about like over the top greed. Gimme, gimme, mine, mine, none for you. Jesus is saying, be careful, take care, protect yourself against the least bit of greed, because life is not defined by what you have, even when you have a lot. And then he told him the story. Now remember, it's a story, it's a parable, so it's not facts or details, it's to elicit, it's a metaphor of life, it's not life itself. He told him the story, the farm of a certain rich man. All right, so let me stop. I'm just going to point out key facets that you might just read by quickly if you were reading this on your own. And I mean, some of it might be no-brainers, but I want to point out that it says rich man. You're like, no kidding, Mike. But think about that for a second. So this guy already has a lot. He already has a lot, all right? So the farm of a certain rich man produced a terrific crop. So he's a wealthy farm owner in the ancient Near East, so it's not, don't think Midwest in 10,000 acres. think people just trying to survive, but this guy's doing it well. He's got the land, the land is productive, and this year he is killing it. He's killing it. It produced a terrific crop, and he talked to himself. He said to himself, what can I do? This harvest is amazing. My barn isn't big enough for this harvest. Then he says, here's what I'll do. I'll tear those down and I'll upgrade. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Let me pause right there, and we'll continue with the parable in a second, but I just want to talk about a few things. First of all, it's a cool story. It's an awesome problem to have, right? I have so much wheat. I where am I going to put it all? I can't store it all. Now, first of all, Jesus, I want to be clear that this isn't a parable about the dangers of success. There's nothing wrong with success. In fact, success is a gift itself. If we were to stop and analyze everything, everything that has led up to this moment has been a gift from God for this guy. First of all, he was born into the right family. He was born into a family that owned land. That is more of a rare thing than a everybody's parents owned land. Not back then. That there was an extreme amount of poverty. So this guy was born into the right family. He owned land, and he had a decent brain on his head on his shoulders, and he had decent enough health to work the farm and to hire workers and to think strategically about planting and to do all the right things to help it grow. And so all that is a gift. The brains, the health, the family that owns the land, all of that is a gift. Then on this particular season, everything lines up. The water, the drainage, the sunlight, the seed, all of it combined, all of it's on its A game. And it peaks at the right moment, and it produces a terrific crop. It could have been the exact opposite. There could have been a drought. It could have been scorching heat, no water. He could have had bad seed. He could have, a fire could have taken place and burnt down his field. None of that happened. Every little detail turned out right for him to have a super crop. That is a gift. Success is a gift. Intellect is a gift. Skills, talent is a gift. Creativity is a gift. Perseverance, the ability, grit is a gift. Being born in the place you were born at, into the circumstances you were born into, is a gift. And so he says, so success isn't a bad thing. And the question, what can I do, isn't a bad thing. That's an important thing. What shall I do about this? But the thing is, he didn't see life as a gift. He didn't see success as a gift. He had a little bit of greed. And greed is super tricky. Greed is super slippery. Greed tries to, without you knowing it, get you to be front and center. Greed sneaks in and says, you owe this to yourself. You owe yourself. This is mine. This is for me. And greed whispers, it's all about you. This is your hard work. This is your talent. You deserve this. This is yours. And it pushes out the gratitude and the awareness that it's all a gift. It's all gravy. None of this had to happen. You could have been born in a different country, in a different time, with no parents. You could have been born without health, without skill. You could have been born in a nine-year drought where everything dies. And so greed comes in and says, it's all about you. And so he says, what do you do? So he says, what can I do? I know what I'll do. I'll upgrade. Now, this doesn't sound super bad, right? I mean, wouldn't, like, if you're killing it and you have no place to put whatever you're killing, you got to find a spot, right? But remember, this is the ancient Near East. This is peasants and poverty and hunger is everywhere, everywhere. And what does this guy have? This guy has so much food, he can't put it in it. He can't store it. He has so much, he can't lock it away. He can't, his barns would be bursting. His barns would be overfilling. He doesn't have enough space to put it. At that point, do you stop and consider your neighbor? Do you stop and consider your community? Do you stop and consider anyone else other than yourself? That's the insidiousness of greed. Greed gets you focused on other things that revolve around you, and you don't see need. You don't see, how can I partner with God with all this excess? And so the guy says, I'm going to upgrade my barns. I'm going to build bigger barns. I owe myself this. Look, there's a few ways we can handle wealth, and I'm going to get, everybody was making fun of my slide this morning. I'm going to show you an Excel chart that I made, and it's called Wealth Identity Analysis, okay? You can make fun of it if you want, but let me tell you that there's only really three ways to handle wealth, to handle resources, to handle income. And this is where I'll do some self-confession. So the blue line you see there is spending. You can spend your wealth on yourself, all right? You can spend your income, you can use your resources all on yourself, right? That's blue, spending. The orange is saving. Saving's the other thing, another thing you can do. There's basically three things: spending, saving, where you save it for yourself. You can spend it for yourself, you could save it for yourself. See how I'm emphasizing that? Spending for yourself, saving for yourself. Or there's a third option. You can serving. You can use your resources, you can use your space, you can use your money, you can use your time, you can use your possessions to serve others. That's basically all you can do with it. And so this wealth identity analysis, it sounds like an awesome investment strategy chart, is not. It's basically a tool that I use to take a look at myself. And I'm asking you to use to take a look at yourself. Are you a spender? In this case, this person has spent 90% of their income, saved about 7.5%, and given 2.5%. I've looked like that in big portions of my life. I was a spender. Now, I didn't make this, but just for the sake of easy math, let's just say I made 100 grand. 100 grand is actually the median income for Norfolk County. So Franklin, you know, whatever the other towns are. So 100K. 90,000, I would have, if I had that kind of income in when I was living this category, $90,000 would have went to spending. $7,500 would have went to savings. And then $2,500 would have went to serving. Oh, I bought this person this. I gave my church this. I supported this cause. I helped somebody out with this. $2,500. I just want to let that sit for a second, because I want to say that most people don't give $2,500 a year. But here's the deal. They make more than $100,000 a year. We are a greedy culture. Just call it out. Do you think saving, grabbing 97.5% resources for you, saving for you, spending for you, is not greedy? Here's another way you could do it. You could be a saver. I only spent $60,000 and I saved $37,500. You should see my portfolios. I still only gave $2,500. Spender, saver. Now, I made this category server. And I said, hey, I spent 60% of my income on myself, or my household income on my family. I saved a bunch. I was able to save, I can't remember the exact number. Let's call it 25. Call it 25%. So that's 85%. I could give away 15%. I could serve people, serve God, serve opportunities and need, and partner with God in whatever capacity I intentionally choose. Maybe some to the church, maybe some to this, maybe some to that. It doesn't matter. But I'm intentionally breaking free 15% of my wealth. Now, if I ever said that to the average person, you should give away 15% of your wealth, you'd be like, what are you, off your rocker? I just want to use this as a measuring stick. I have never been a saver. I'm never going to fall into that category. But I've been on the serving side of things, and I've been on the spending side of things. And I got to tell you, the serving side of things is fantastic. When you watch, money's tough. You don't want to do this. But one of the best things I ever did once, I had this this really tricked out Toyota Camry. It goes with the Excel spreadsheet slide. It was an accountant's dream. It had a sunroof. It had the little whale tail. Toyota Camry, it was red. Had a little fin in the back. Had the moonroof, sunroof, or whatever. Had the wood interior. It was really nice. I love that car. And there was this guy that was, his family was kind of the black sheep of the community. But I really liked this guy. And always making bad decisions. And he got in a car accident and his car was totaled. And he commuted like 40 minutes a day up to support his family at this job. And he was in danger of losing his job. At this time in my life, I worked 9 miles from my, I mean, sorry, 0.9 miles from my house. I worked less than a mile from my house. And so Laura and I and the kids circled up, and I'm like, hey, we can live off one car, right? And we gave him the Camry. I can't tell you how awesome that was for me and my family. Just to be able to see someone not tank and see the hope and the optimism and the fuel it gave that guy and their family. It was fantastic. I don't know who benefited more, us or them. Until actually the church I was working with felt so bad they got us, that I had to walk to work. They got this jalopy that kept breaking down. then I regretted that. But that's another side story. I hope that church isn't watching right now. It was a long time ago. all that to say is, it is really, really hard not to be greedy. It is really, really easy gravitational pull to fit into the spender or the saver, spending for yourself or saving and spending for yourself. It's hard, but it's life-giving. Let's keep with the parable. The parable takes a weird twist, and I think Jesus is trying to make a poignant point here. Just then, God shows up. Continue the parable. Just then, God shows up. You foolish man, this very night your soul is demanded of you. And as for all that you have prepared, who will own it now? Jesus often does this. He sets people up in a parable, and then, like, right when they're on the trap door, he springs it. And so everybody's probably tracking with the story. And then Jesus wraps up the story quickly by saying, this guy had the perfect crop, was wondering how he could make his barns bigger, and he didn't realize it was the end of the line for him. Where's all that wealth going? Where's all that wheat going? Where's all those barns going now? And Jesus uses it. It's not reality. It's a metaphor about reality. And Jesus is using it to make a huge, huge point. And I want to make that point by borrowing from another pastor. This is like 20 years ago. John Ortberg had a great sermon on this, and he used a Monopoly illustration. And he said, Monopoly is a great game about life because you can get all the houses, you can get all the hotels, you can accumulate all kinds of property and cash, and you can suck all your friends dry and bleed them until you're the Monopoly champion of the night. But no matter how much you won, at the end of the night, all the houses, all the hotels, all the cash, all the property cards go back into the box, and the box goes away. Games are like that. My family, a few years back, bought Settlers of Catan. Anybody play Settlers of Catan? And my family's probably sitting on the couch saying, no, Dad, don't tell the story. But I just took to it. Like, it's just it's perfect for the way I think. And I became the Bill Belichick of Settlers of Catan. I had like a 73% winning streak, like 3.5 games out of 4 I would win. And everybody stopped wanting to play with me. But here's the deal. No matter how much resources, no matter how many armies and roads and victory cards and resources I amassed, at the end of the day, it all goes back in the box. And the box goes back in the cabinet. Games are like that, but you know what? Life is like that. No matter how much we amass, no matter how much we accumulate, Jesus' parable is saying it all goes back in the box. So watch out for the least bit of greed. A bunch of us had the privilege of attending a funeral for an NEC person that recently passed away after a long bout of cancer. And the funeral was amazing. It was like a two-hour celebration of all the ways this guy had made an impact. Everybody was coming up and saying, this person served me this way, this person served me this way. It was amazing. It was really a celebration of life. So much different than the, I'm just going to upgrade my barns. Are you a spender? Are you a saver? Or you're a server? God loves success. Success is a gift. God loves enjoying eating and drinking and stuff. Those are all gifts. But greed gets in there and distracts us and makes us discontent and makes us think, you owe yourself. I owe myself this. I owe me this. And the next thing you know it, we look more like the guy in the parable than the person who's bearing the image and likeness and goodness of God. There's one more scripture verse that kind of sums this all up. It comes in a different part. It comes in a New Testament letter called 1 Timothy. It's a letter that the Apostle Paul writes to this guy named Timothy, and he's warning Timothy. He says, hey, godliness, all right, godliness is actually loving and serving people. That's what God does. For God so loved the world, he gave. God is always sacrificing, calling us in, sharing. Generous God, generous people. So godliness, serving others, actually is a means of great gain when accompanied with contentment. For we have brought nothing into the world. We can take nothing out of it either. But here's the deal. You can't just resolve to be content. I'm going to be content with what I have. And then the marketing and the next iPhone and the next this will come out. You can't just resolve to be content. You got to let God open your eyes. You got to let God do some work. You got to be tenacious and getting rid of discontentment. And one of the best ways to do that is to serve people. Serve people with your time, serve people with your resources, serve people with your money. And then as you do, you see God partnering with you and discontentment floats away. And you realize that you are indeed the owner of all good things. And you could share them and you could use them. You could serve with all that you've been entrusted. We could really, really make a difference as people if we move from spenders or savers to servers. We can still spend, we can still save, but if we intentionally serve also, wow, what an impact. Think of us collectively, a church of 500, 600, 700 people, all adopting a serving mindset. How would the food pantries, how would the causes, how would the neighborhood change? Let me say a prayer for us. Heavenly Father, I confess that at times I am greedy. I buy the lie. I slip into the discontentment. God, forgive us when we do this and give us eyes to see the possibilities, the abundance you're calling us to partner with you, to serve others, and to enjoy life. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
So speaking of gifts, I should mention that today is the first day we're using this beautiful gift that someone gave to the NEC community. And I got to tell you, it was so incredibly generous. It really plays into Mike's message today. So really happy, very thankful that this person gave of herself. It was very, very generous. The first two songs we sang today were rather contemplative. This third song is a lot more hopeful. And if you would like to sing at home, that would help me out a lot, so please do.
It don't have a job, won't pay your bills, won't buy you a home in Beverly Hills. Won't fix your life in five easy steps. Ain't the law of the land or the government, but it's all you. Love will hold us together, make us a shelter to weather the storm. And I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone. It's waiting for you, knocking at your door. Every moment of truth when your heart hits the floor. And you're on your knees. us a shelter to weather the storm, and I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone. This is the first day of the rest of your life. This is the first day of the rest of your life. Cause even in the dark, you can still see the light. It's gonna be all right. And love will hold us together, make us a shelter to weather the storm. And I'll be mother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone. So the whole world will know that we're not alone.
Thanks, Mark. I'll be humming that all day. Toxic people is it's a tough topic, as Mike pointed out at the beginning, and they all those things kind of blend in together, because when I think about fear that we talked about last week and greed, those two really sync up for me. I'm afraid to part with things. I'm afraid to part with money. We're all a work in progress, right? And I like to think of these services and these messages as just like a time to hit pause and reflect a little. And with today's weather, what else are you going to do? But we hope that you have a cozy day, a warm day. We hope that you feel God's presence. We hope that you know when he looks at you as his creation, that he sees perfection and he feels such love towards us. We miss all of you, and we hope to be together soon. Have an awesome day.